let's quickly move on to possibly the next discussion. I can already see a bunch of smiles around the room. I think very clearly the banter did flow during the debate. Allow me to start off by introducing my next set of panelists. Abhishek Surendran, partner at Pi Ventures. Abhishek Shah, co-founder and CEO of Wealthy Therapeutics. Mr. Mohan Kumar, partner at NVP. And Viren Shetty, Senior Vice President at Narayana Health. This debate panel is possibly going to take a slightly different route in terms of putting forth their viewpoints. Also because I think while they started establishing their thought processes, somewhere they realized that their thought processes are more converging than possibly diverging, as a result of which this format is going to be slightly different. However, the attempt is going to remain the same, where we're going to try and focus and make sure that we get under the skin of every single regulatory data privacy security oriented issue around implementation of artificial intelligence in health tech, in healthcare, particularly in emerging economies. So that's what we're looking at addressing during the course of this panel. I will possibly go around the table and solicit viewpoints individually, and we could definitely argue and counter-argue during the course of the conversation as well. We'll structure this as a 20-minute conversation as well. So to start off with, I think clearly established, and I was just reading about it, I think the chief scientist of Baidu said very recently, right, that AI very clearly is the new electricity. And I think there is no doubt that artificial intelligence is going to take multiple industries by storm. Health tech very clearly is going to be one of them. Possibly this is also an industry where the upside of good implementation of AI can yield significant results. Having said that, I think there are a bunch of challenges on the table for each one of us to solve for before we actually get to that stage where we see this becoming real. So Mohan, why don't I possibly start off with you and possibly seek your views on what you really feel are some of the topmost challenges in the implementation of AI, making that sweeping transformative impact that we're looking for in the times to come.
Yeah, I think how many of you would go to a doctor, it's actually AI, and seek treatment? Probably here, how many? Not many, right? So I think it's the challenges like the patients, right, are not going to a machine or a tech. If you tell them a technology, okay, and it's going to be technology driven, your life is at stake. Okay? You're not going to do that. Okay? Same thing, a doctor also, right, I think is not going to take and say, look, I'm going to be replaced by a machine, okay, IBM Watson and a few others, right? So consumer facing side, I think, in my view, is ruled out. Okay. You can neither tell the patient nor tell the doctor because both are the face to each other. Okay. I think my view where I see the efficiency of AI is the back office for the hospital, okay, where it removes the errors, removes the quality, makes the quality of care to a certain level, okay, which means if you don't have a good radiologist, can technology make the radiologist on par with the best? Okay, yes, that's possible. Okay. So in immediate terms like that, you can look at multiple sector, multiple radiology department, you can look at claims, you can look at multiple departments and make the quality of care to a very high standard using AI as a support. Okay, so that's near term. I think patient going to a machine and doing anything will never happen in the next 10 years.
Sure, thanks so much for that, Mohan. Viren, and I've heard your views in some of the other occasions as well on these areas. Given that India and countries like India very clearly are still at a stage where primary healthcare and access to primary healthcare itself is a challenge. Our data collection processes at the level of the government, at the level of private providers, is not just possibly fragmented but broken at multiple stages. Compounded with the fact that healthcare data is fairly heterogeneous in nature. Which makes interoperability or the intelligence that AI can really a challenge. How do you really see emerging economies possibly circumventing these challenges?
Yeah, no, I mean that's a very fair question. a lot of people ask, you know, why in India, since we can't feed all the people in the country, why we have a space program? Similarly, it's fair to say that in a country where we don't have doctors for everyone, why would you have, you know, any investment at all in AI when you just need very basic tools, you need doctors? Why aren't you solving more of the basic challenges? And the answer is that it's nuanced. At the time that we had ISRO and we had a space program, they came to us and said, look, we have all this excess satellite capacity. Why don't you use it for running telemedicine? And so we used it to run telemedicine, and that sort of launched the notion on a national level that you could access healthcare remotely. And whether it's good or bad, it doesn't matter. It just gives people an option. It never got overhyped in those days, and it was a sort of reasonable thing that doctors were expected. The problem I find with AI now is that it's getting a little out of control, in that AI can solve cancer, AI can take care of all your problems, AI can fix your marriage, AI can, you know, educate your children. Just separate the hype from the, you know, from the reality. And that is something Mohan mentioned earlier. So the most classic example is everyone knows about IBM Watson, right? They came out with a huge splash when it beat a chess player, it beat a player in Jeopardy, and they thought this is like the next big thing. And a bunch of IBM marketing suits went all over the country, all over the world actually, and said, you know, let's sell Watson AI to treat people. And an actual quote from a doctor in a hospital that was using this said this product, one, is a piece of shit, and two, it's been forced onto us by our marketing departments. And on the back of this, a lot of VCs have thrown billions and billions of dollars behind AI. They've driven up the salaries of data scientists across the world. And, you know, companies like us, where we believe in the promise of AI, but we don't think that it's going to be worth billions of dollars tomorrow. Where we are having trouble trying to hire, you know, these data scientists to come and just crunch the back-end data that we have. So I would say yes. I mean, as a country like India, where we have basic problems, we should focus on that. But AI, just take it with a little bit of moderation and not get, you know, too blown away by the idea that I'll stop building hospitals and instead I'll target all my country's resources towards building AI.
Sure. Thanks for that, Viren. In fact, incidentally, while I was listening to you, I realized that possibly AI does solve for broken marriages. You know, given the fact that data scientists' salaries went up, I'm sure a few marriages were saved. Abhishek, you are solving for some of these problems yourself at Wealthy. Would love to hear your views on this.
Yeah. So yeah, it's the hype is extremely high versus the reality. But the way you can sift through the reality is clinical outcomes, publication, real-world evidence, randomized control trials. That thankfully healthcare has laid the pathway to be able to, you know, sift out the riffraff from the real sort of diamonds out there, and there are a few that keep coming up, right? So while IBM Watson is a great example of something that went too extreme with great marketing help, if you look at some of the other guys who are also controversial, and you know they're maybe not all the way there, like say a Babylon Health or an ADA or a K Health, where they're able to use a decision tree pathway to be able to get to a really accurate sort of, you know, take a left, take a right to get to a probable symptom, and then direct you to the right physician because they've, you know, diagnosed the condition fairly well. That's hugely powerful, you know, coming through to what Mohan was saying on augmenting the, you know, existing healthcare infrastructure. And then you look at examples where, say, you know, diabetes retinopathy, where you're able to use convolution neural networks to be able to really build out better models so that you can take an image and really classify it well enough to be able to understand, say, whether a patient is has a risk of or has retinopathy or not, and what's the gradient of it. Where at a primary care setting, this is extremely important. I mean, look at the amount of ophthalmologists out there versus the real sort of problem on the ground. So there are some areas where, frankly, there's no way out except to, you know, go down the path like this, because otherwise you're not going to solve for it. But healthcare has laid the pathway, and that we believe in the same approach, which is that, you know, there's too much noise. You want to get away from the noise and truly see if something works or not, and it's very, very minute and in small pockets, where, forget the hype, but there's real outcome happening. Look for clinical evidence, look for publications, look for physicians recommending it, look for ways in which healthcare is adopting it, and you will find that there are small little diamonds in the rough available in a very, very vast sort of desert out there, which hopefully over a period of time will, you know, sanitize itself.
Abhishek, I think at Pi Ventures, you guys are kind of trying to find these diamonds in the desert, right, that Abhishek spoke about. I'm also told Pi Ventures kind of focuses on, you know, AI-led investments in a way. How mature do you think is the startup ecosystem that you guys are investing into at this point in time? And how deep is their focus on you know, issues around, let's say, data security, privacy, particularly in the healthcare space where these are extremely sensitive issues that we deal with? What kind of focus do you really see coming in from startups in this space?
Okay, so so healthcare is a strong focus area for us. So we have done 3 investments in healthcare. If you talk about the ecosystem, it's growing. I think there's lots to be improved. But at the same time, what we see is that it's you know, probably the direction is right. So we invested in a company called Sigtuple, which recently raised a lot of capital. And the focus is what we have understood is that if you're trying to sell a software solution in India, it's always going to be very difficult. The GTM needs to be really worked out for an AI startup. And today, the focus for a lot of AI startups is to become full stack, start offering the solution by yourself, right, than trying to sell the solution to a hospital. So what we see is, you know, a lot of new age startups coming up. There's a good dermatology startup, just forgetting the name. But, you know, you can take a photograph of your face and it'll find out whether you have an acne or the pimple, and it can give you recommendations on it. And they also give you, and they mail you the, you know, creams and all that you need. So, you know, and that, you know, they're doing phenomenally well. So there's been a huge customer traction of it. So I think, from, you know, to perhaps what Mohan was mentioning, you know, customers might not go directly and ask a computer whether I have an issue and take diagnosis from a computer. But there are a lot of changes. I think the millennials are changing it. People are taking a lot of advice on Facebook and some of the social networks. But not perhaps for a very serious issue, say like cancer, but for some small time, you know, you have a small rash, just take a photograph, a computer will tell you what to do. So as far as our thesis goes, we are looking at, you know, image analysis based AI startups, because if you see, especially the technology, is, especially on the AI side, is far more mature on image analysis. And so any startup that has a proprietary source of data on the imaging front and can use AI to, you know, to quickly find out the issues, I think that's a great thing. And to answer your question on security and privacy, I think India is perhaps the only country in the world which has a fairly relaxed way of sourcing data for medical. And we have a huge regulatory advantage over the West in this field. And a lot of you know, large companies, especially, you know, the Microsofts, Googles of the world, have all set up large data collection teams in India. So I think we you know, we shouldn't really lose that advantage. Phenomenal work is happening, especially to collect you know, radiology samples or you know, any imaging diagnostic product. So my take on that is that, you know, be as regulatory light, be as data privacy light as possible to help this, you know, to help the technology really succeed.
Viren, I think you have something to add to that.
Yeah, look, this was probably, maybe I'm just asking another question. As we're building out different AI programs and implementing it in every aspect of life, you have to realize that in the end, this is AI as applied to humans. And for whatever reason, we apply machines to a much higher standard of accuracy. For those who remember, who follow on self-driving cars, Uber had one accident with the machine, 3 people died, and Uber sort of suspended the self-driving program. Google also, they had a collision. Tesla, the guy sort of ran into a truck and then they stopped self-driving across all their cars. The error rate is minuscule. I mean, it's fractions of a percent for the machine, but all it takes is one thing to go wrong, and entire companies, entire governments, everyone will step in, and they're going to say, you know what, no more self-driving, no more AI, no more making, you know, machines make the decision. The worry I have is that as more and more of this algorithmic decision-making gets implemented into either a doctor's decision or a pilot, or you start to see humans take a back seat. The most classic example is, I don't know where anything is anymore because I have Google Maps. I didn't need to worry about coming to Yeshwanthpur, even figuring out where Yeshwanthpur is, because I put Google Maps, and I've lost the ability to navigate. I've outsourced that entirely to the machine. If I mess up, I'm going to react very strongly against Google. So the one worry is that it is making us, in a sense, I wouldn't say dumber, but it's not allowing us to exercise as many brain cells in something that's important as we should. But two, and this I think is the far more important thing, is that you're going to have a situation where humans will just wash their hands of their responsibility, which is the driver of the self-driving car or the doctor doing the diagnosis on AI will say, you know what, it's not my fault the patient died, the machine said that this was supposed to happen. And you're putting suddenly the burden of patient care on technologists who, you know, if you ask Abhishek or if you ask any of these teams, what are they building? They say, look, we're building software, we're building decision trees, we're not building a better way to treat people. Because junk data comes in, a junk result is going to come out. And that's the growing challenge you're going to find as we start implementing more and more of this in the workspace. And it's something everyone who's building AI solution needs to constantly stress from day one, is that it actually goes against your own marketing in a way, in that you can't stress that we're giving you a better result. Because then it means that you are, in a sense, competing for the decision, and in which case you're going to have the human then take a backseat and say, fine, you make all the decisions and we're not going to take any responsibility for what happens.
Fair point. Abhishek, quickly to ask you something specifically on this. Now, you guys are anyways, you're a consumer-facing AI company, you know, by and large, if I get that right. What kind of emphasis are you guys possibly placing on, you know, things like data security and privacy? You know, there's a data protection bill which is on the way, you know, which is likely to change life significantly for all of us, right? So as a startup in this space, what's your focus on data privacy, security kind of issues at this point in time? Because all of us are reading about increasingly, you know, how India today is being used, you know, for you know, data experiments on ophthalmology, for example. So how can we protect ourselves against, you know, trends like these?
So I'll give you an interesting example, right? We went to, so we build ourselves towards being a software as a drug. This category of medicine is just not there in this country. We tried very hard with the FDA to get them to regulate us, but it's not something that's yet found its time. So there were two choices: continue to go, you know, use the regulatory light landscape that we have, or go one step further. So we are now getting classified as a software as a medical device in other markets, and we are going to go into FDA in markets where software as a drug is classified. So first and foremost is, the way to solve for it is to hold yourself to a higher standard than the standards that currently are there, because those are the standards that you need to get to always as you think of yourself, and especially because we're trying to build, or we are building this company to be in multiple markets, both heavily regulated as well as unregulated. And therefore, you have to take the, you know, the best of both. So step one was that. And the other piece is, we may be consumer focused, and ironically, you know, when patients describe what we do, we are like a Google Maps or a Google navigation for their everyday life and managing the particular chronic condition that our users are using. But we don't go B2C. It's so, you know, anti, you know, thought process where, you know, it's only prescribed by a physician, it only goes through a payer, it only goes through a healthcare ecosystem partner, because again, it holds you to a higher standard. Because let's face it, when you're working in healthcare, and it's not just diagnosis, because our job, what we do is treat or help or intervene, we are liable. So software as a drug means, if the drug fails, you are liable. Same way, there's no question, you know, through the previous panel, if we screw up, we are liable. That's what makes us a software as a drug. So as long as you can figure out what matters in your piece of the puzzle that you're solving for, and hold yourself to the standards, because those standards may not exist in India, but it's not like they don't exist anywhere in the world. Find them, emulate them, there is light at the end of the tunnel, and then you still use the pathway to get there to be more, you know, regularly light, so that you're able to sort of spend the early time when you're in experimentation mode, not having to deal with the red tape that healthcare offers, but the yellow tape that I guess India offers.
Mohan, you had some thoughts on that.
It's very interesting, right? You said Google Maps. Have you ever searched any symptom on Google? You have a knee problem, you have a, it'll all lead to cancer. Everything you need, you'll say. So there's a study done in US. Look, all you do is go Google what problems you have. You will have cancer, 100%, okay? And you'll panic. Okay? So the thing is, right, the predictive models in healthcare doesn't work, okay? It's as good as the data you collect, okay? So it's decision tree, or it's what has happened before, okay? And what conditions has happened before, what has doctor treated, and based on that, you should make sure you don't miss it, or basically improve the productivity. You come with predictive models and say, look, I have a new symptom, you'll all go to cancer. So the problem, predictive model doesn't work in healthcare, okay? The mistakes are too costly, okay? Even one mistake, you don't mind having one car accident, okay, if you don't die, okay? But as a patient, if you take one mistake, okay, you die, right? You don't want, So for collectively, it may be a low percentage, but individually, it's 100%, okay? You may go there.
Sure.
So I think predictive models are tough, okay? In India, coming to emerging markets, my view is, India, you keep hearing that doctors are not enough, okay? It takes 10 to 15 years to get a doctor qualified, come up to speed, okay? Question is, what do we do? How do we improve the productivity of the existing doctor 5 times, okay? The shortage is only 2 or 3 times, okay? We improve the productive doctor twice or thrice, you solve the problem. And that's where AI can help. Long run, make the doctor productive, make sure every GP is working 8 to 10 hours a day, whether you see the patient or not see the patient. Spread it out, okay? Instead of morning or evening concentration. I think that's where the opportunities are.
Sure, I think great points there. Would love to take questions from the audience if there are any. I'm sure there were some interesting viewpoints being tabled there. Please.
Well, one question is that for hospitals and maybe going to mostly because do anything in the AI sector or machine learning, first is data.
And the second thing is that we don't see a lot of telemedicine machines installed first. So we are a cardiology company. I know that if you look at telemedicine cardiology, it's only about 2,000 machines as of now, and in the last 3 years. Probably 1,000 plus, which are from the NH side of the story, which are the older side, which do not have any way to give you that raw data. Where are we going there? I mean, where is that focus? Because I don't see any investment, anything going in the devices side. Without the devices giving you data, there's no way you're going to have data. You don't have data, you're not going to get a predictive model. So then it's all, as Viren said, junk in, junk out, right?
Your question is to someone specific?
Yeah, I mean, Viren, because it's the hospital side of the story.
Yeah, look, it's a lot more than, okay, telemedicine solves one problem. Why isn't telemedicine working? It's not just because the data acquisition or the devices aren't being sold. There's the question of the entire ecosystem around it. We run telemedicine essentially as a combination of CSR and marketing outreach. And so when a doctor is giving his advice on telemedicine, he's taking time out of his day at no extra remuneration to go and do this work. And so that's why you haven't seen too many hospitals, you know, just have entire departments dedicated to telemedicine, because for whatever reason, patients don't want to pay for something they've been conditioned to get for free on the phone. Okay. Now, I'm not going to go and fight against that. This is just the reality of the market. So if you're asking why isn't better data being acquired through telemedicine, I'd say this is the highly specific answer. But the broader question of why isn't good data being acquired full stop, I would say because EMR is crap. Most hospitals have terrible EMR. Most clinics don't even want EMR. Through various combinations, one is it's too expensive, it's a change of behavior. It introduces this layer of accountability to a lot of doctors that they may not necessarily want. A lot of doctors, they work in an offline world, essentially. Just trying to digitize those interactions is a step change in behavior for them that most people don't want. So those are core problems that you need to solve. You know, solve data acquisition first, then you can worry about what to do with the data.
Sure. Thanks for that. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining us for this panel. Extremely valuable viewpoints. Small token of appreciation. Yeah.
you are